Well, sailing around the world is terribly simple from a navigation point of view. You leave Britain, turn left, go down until you reach Cape Town, turn left, go around to Cape Horn, turn left, come up the Atlantic, smell fish and chips, turn right, and there's England.
Robin wasn't a traditional yachtsman. He'd come out of the British Merchant Navy. Back in those days, he was almost Battle of Trafalgar type British.
And then I heard that a Frenchman was planning to build a boat, and I thought, well, it'd be much nicer if an Englishman did it first, so I planned to go.
Once I'd started thinking about it, I got more and more obsessed with the idea. What we didn't know is if a boat would stay in one piece much after Australia if it didn't have a refit. If you look at the nine of us who set out, we've got totally different boats. No one knew what the ideal boat was. Well, the first thing I wanted was a darn good sponsor. But I wrote to about 52 companies and asked them to support me, and they all wrote back saying no. I did get a £5 voucher from Cadbury's, which is very useful. And much more usefully, 120 cans of beer from Tennent's. But that was the limit of my sponsorship, so I just took the boat I had. Single-handed sailing is in the mind. It's not in muscles. If you're racing, it's that ability to never sleep when the boat needs looking after. Boat needs more sail, needs less sail. You cannot sleep until the boat is right. And I went into the Southern Ocean at the beginning of Southern Spring. That's a bit too soon. I didn't have any choice in the matter. And I ran into, what, 6 gales in 10 days. And the 6th one was a real bastard. So you get waves coming from one direction, and then the wind swings and it builds the waves up from the other, so you get a cross sea. And that is the worst possible situation for a small boat. One of them slammed me over, threw me straight on the side. I guess threw me about 110, 120 degrees. I don't really know. All I know is I found a penny that was somewhere in the cabin stuck underneath the deck frames. Well, the boat was all right. She bounced upright. Nothing was serious was broken, I thought. But then in daylight, after I'd started tidying up, I realized the self-steering was damaged. Lost all my fresh water. Bilge water got into it, so it's now poisonous. From then on, next 8 months, I had to catch rain. Because the cabin had shifted with the force of the blow, water was now dripping inside, and so I lost the use of the transmitter.
What do you do when you're alone by yourself for 10 months? I guess the only people who've ever even come close to that would be prisoners in solitary confinement. But that's what these guys were. They were prisoners in solitary confinement.
I never thought really seriously about retiring. Each day was a day when I'd worked hard to progress. Therefore, if I had a bad day, you know, I was feeling slightly depressed, I would say to myself, well, I've no right to let the me down who's got me this far. So snap out of it. Go and read a book.
We were assuming that his radio receiver was working, so I enlisted the help of all the radio stations in southern New Zealand.
Well, the New Zealand radio station did, it just kept transmitting a message. It knew I couldn't answer. He kept transmitting a message in the hope I'd pick it up, saying, you know, waiting for you near Bluff. Right, I said, I'll go to Bluff and look for it.
What do you want to do when the voyage is over?
Hot bath.
Anything else?
Steak, egg and chips with, new boiled potatoes, fresh peas, a beautiful juicy sirloin steak, medium rare.
And he was sitting on a fishing boat about 8 feet from me, we're chatting. And I said, well, have you got my mail? He said, yes, but you can't have it. I said, what do you mean I can't have it? He said, no, Sunday Times have changed the rules. If I give you these letters, it counts as outside assistance. And I thought, that is absolutely stupid. So Bruce sat there opening my letters and reading them to me.
And lemon meringue pie. Oh, and the first thing, a pint of English beer.
He brought me up to date with the state of the race. Blythe and Ridgeway were out. Fougeron, he was out. Bill King was out. So the one I had to watch was Mattesier. Where was he?
Mattesier was making some really good gains at that time. He was doing 150, 170 miles a day, while Robin was doing less than 100 miles. So the gap between them was closing all the time.
I was conscious of a steely-eyed Frenchman not far behind me, sort of vive la France, vive de Gaulle, and never sleepy and crashing on after me. And that sort of acted as a fairly good prod in the backside to keep moving. Cape Horn, the reason why it's so ferocious is because South America sticks down closer to Antarctica than any other land. So you've got a 600-mile gap. Now you've got 2,000-mile wide ocean that's been compressed through that gap, so that currents are quite strong through it. Plus it shoals, it gets shallow there, which means the waves heap up. Plus you've got the Andes chain, which forces the winds to go through the gap. Everyone's aware of the fact that if it's going to be nasty, that's the one place you don't want to be caught. I was actually about 7 miles off Cape Horn when I went past. But of course, I got absolutely flat becalmed. And then the next day I had a gale from the other direction. That's Cape Horn. By that time I'd become a creature of the sea. I was very happy in my own little world. When your life is dominated by the weather and the waves, home becomes really rather an abstract thought. They didn't know if I was alive or not, and indeed, the indications at one stage were that I probably would never be seen again. I had no idea I was in the lead, I didn't realize that. And I ran into the main transatlantic shipping lane between America and the Mediterranean, and I saw a French ship and I called him up and I asked where Matessier was. He said, in the Indian Ocean. I said, no way. Absolutely no way. No way, no logical reason why Matessier would be in the Indian Ocean. And I came to the conclusion he must be very close to me. It was a French plot to make me slow down. And it wasn't for another week, and I was able to get through and talk to my brother. I said, where's Matessier? He said, in the Indian Ocean. I thought, God, the French have got at my family as well. And then I became aware, because I was listening in to the radio stations, I began to be aware of chatter of boats talking about coming out to meet me. And that's when they said to me, you know, what time are you going to finish? And I said, no, wind howls, I'll finish at 9 a.m. And they said, look, would you mind slowing up? And I said, what? And they said, look, the Maris is getting her hair done at 9 to greet you. And she won't be ready till 10, so would you mind slowing up? So I slowed up. The wind changed just after 9. I didn't get in till 3:30 in the afternoon, by which time, of course, the poor dear's hairstyle was ruined anyway.
And the cannon is gone. Day 312, about 25 past 3 on April the 22nd, and Robin Knox-Johnston and Sue Haley have sailed non-stop.
I guess Robin was looking even then at a whole new life opening up ahead. He had a book lying ahead, a US lecture tour, all sorts of things were suddenly going to open up, bringing home to him just how changed his life was going to be.
For me, you know, it was a dream. This wasn't the real world. This isn't real. Real world's out there on a boat with waves and wind.